Hi, I'm Tim Berglund with Confluent. Let's talk now about how to integrate Kafka into your environment and some of the other elements of Kafka as a platform beyond just the fundamentals. Now, when you're done with this module, here's what I want you to be able to do. You should be able to explain how the Confluent REST proxy works, talk about the Confluent Schema Registry and why it's an essential part of a streaming platform centered around Kafka, sketch out kind of how and where Kafka Connect gets used and really what it's for, and also talk about main features of Kafka Streams and the goals of ksqlDB. I want you to have a good picture. And all these things together, these really fill out Kafka, not just as a distributed log with this produce and consume thing, but really a whole event streaming platform. Now, you could, by writing your own producers and consumers, integrate Kafka with any system in the world. If you know how to read data from something, a relational database, a mainframe, an S3 bucket, whatever, you know, you could do that interfacing and then produce those records into Kafka. Likewise, if you know how to write to something, Elasticsearch, Cassandra, even HDFS, if you want, you could subscribe to a topic, consume from that topic, and write those messages out to that sync. You could do that, but you shouldn't because it's already been done. That's what Kafka Connect is. It's a distributed, fault-tolerant, pluggable, declarative data integration framework to get data into Kafka and out of Kafka, to integrate Kafka with legacy systems and external systems that aren't Kafka. Connect is its own infrastructure. It runs on its own server, its own instance, even a cluster of Connect servers, and that's those Connect API boxes you see there. That's Connect running a server process external to the Kafka cluster. So on the source side, it's reading from some external system and producing into the cluster. And on the sync side, it's consuming from some Kafka topic and then writing into that external system. One of the most important things about Connect is the library of connectors. If you just look at these logos for these systems, you know, you've got S3 and Elasticsearch and GDBC databases and InfluxDB and Salesforce and all these things. You don't want to write that data integration code yourself. If it's been written once somewhere in the world in a way that's reusable by you, you want to use that thing. Because adding that code or creating that code yourself, writing those connectors yourself, if they already exist, doesn't create any unique and differentiated value for you and for your customers and for your organization. You always, always, always want to take that kind of thing when you can. So there's this extensive library of literally hundreds of connectors that exist in the world. They're pluggable into Connect, and then you give it a little bit of declarative configuration information. That connector is off and running, doing its integration thing. Very, very powerful. Connect is a distributed system. You see here there are N workers in this Connect cluster. That could be 3, that could be 5, it could be 1. You know, those are all valid values of N for that Connect cluster. And each Connect worker runs one or more tasks. Each task is running a piece of a connector. If you can see the yellow boxes in each worker, connector A, task 1, connector A, task 2, connector A, task 3. So that's a connector that's able to be partitioned into 3 pieces. If you could imagine a sync connector that's consuming from a topic and, let's say, writing to Elasticsearch. If that topic has 3 partitions or more than 3 partitions, then those partitions can be assigned to those tasks. And Connect is able to parallelize the work of reading from that topic and writing into Elasticsearch. Those other tasks, whatever they might be, these same connectors can be partitioned and split among multiple workers. Now, not every connector is able to be partitioned. So if, for example, I am a source connector reading from a single database table in a relational database, well, that's going to be a single thread proposition. So there'll be one worker that has one task that's running that connector. But in general, connectors can be parallelized, and the work of distributing those tasks among the workers is done automatically by Connect. And the failover, if one of those workers goes away, of course, those connectors need to have remembered where they were, whether they were reading from some outside source or writing to some outside sync. Keeping track of where they were is a thing that Connect does automatically and stores that in that that Kafka topic, that internal Kafka topic you see at the bottom of the slide, that current state is managed inside the cluster. So you've got scalability and fault tolerance in Connect through those mechanisms. The Confluent REST proxy is really just a REST wrapper around the producer and the consumer. Think of it that way. Now, whatever language you're using, you almost certainly have support, community support, if nothing else, for some Kafka library. But if you don't want to do that, if you want to use an HTTP interface, the REST proxy lets you do that. It's a way to produce messages into topics, subscribe to topics, and consume from them, all through a fairly simple RESTful interface. And it also exposes certain administrative capabilities over that same interface. Now, if you can imagine building something big with Kafka, you've got lots of topics with data in them and many producers and many consumers, and maybe you've got a few topics that really are elevated in importance, and you find that that's very valuable data that lots of consumers have emerged to process in different ways. Well, there's a problem lurking here, and that problem is schema evolution. Now, schema evolution is always difficult, even in the way we've traditionally built systems as large monolithic applications with a database at the center. Migrating the schema of that database is not easy. And certain tools and practices have emerged around schema migration in those legacy systems, and the Confluent Schema Registry is our answer to that in Kafka, because you want to be able to version producers and consumers independently. They're already decoupled. So you want to be able to maybe release a new version of a consumer before you've got the producer caught up to be producing that new data format. Or, you know, you've updated the producer, but there are 15 consumers of that topic and you can't version them all at once. There's different teams responsible for them. You want some of them to be able to be on the old version and have that compatibility with that old data in the old version of the consumer. These are real problems, and we need to be able to solve them. That's what Schema Registry does. With the Schema Registry, you define the schema for messages that are going to be in a topic. You generally do that through some kind of IDL or interface description language. Like in the case of AVRO serialized messages, you'll use AVSC. We'll take a look at some AVSC in a minute. But you have this definition, this really text file that defines the schema of that message. And typically the process will look like this. You'll have some automated task in your build that will turn that type description into a language type. Like it'll create a Java class with that schema, and then you can use that Java class as a domain object, and producers and consumers will really automatically know how to serialize and deserialize that in a way that keeps the schema registry aware of that schema. Also, at build time, there are ways of saying, hey, look, I've got a new version of this schema. Is this going to work? So I can know if my new proposed schema is going to work, given my new schema compatibility settings that I've got configured for the topic of interest. So helps us with schema evolution. That's super important. Schema is always going to change. There's no getting around that. And helps us make runtime and build time assertions of schema compatibility. Just to give you a quick idea how it works. Schema registry is, like Connect, a process that runs outside the cluster. There's a server or maybe a few instances in HA configuration being the schema registry. The actual schemas are going to be kept in, no big surprise, an internal topic in the Kafka cluster. And the producer and the consumer actually talk over the network to the schema registry. When it comes time to produce a message with a new schema that the producer hasn't seen before, it'll say, hey, schema registry, here's this schema. Is this compatible? Okay, good. I'll go on. It'll cache it locally, so it's not doing that network hop all the time, and go ahead and do the produce. Likewise, on the consume side, the consumer will get that message out. There'll be a little schema ID in there. And if the consumer's never seen that, it'll go ask the schema registry, hey, give me the full definition of this schema. And so then the consumer will be able to make assertions about whether that version of the message is going to be compatible with the version of the schema that the consumer currently has. So that's basically how that works at runtime. This lets you make runtime assertions at produce and consume time. Hey, when I'm writing this message, am I going to break consumers out there? When I'm reading this message in, that's maybe something I didn't expect. Is it going to break me as a consumer? I mentioned the IDL, and the interface description language. This is the AVRO version of such. This is AVSC, an AVRO schema file. And you can see it's JSON. That's a fairly lightweight description of the type. And this will be a text file that in a lot of cases, a team will say, nope, this is the type and this is source controlled. This is checked in with the project. It's part of the same repo. And now when I want to change this, this is a change I can negotiate with the team the way I negotiate any other code change through a pull request. So I can propose that change. The team can say, oh, wait, if you do that, it's going to break this thing. Or no, that's fine. Go ahead. And so schema evolution becomes a thing that we negotiate just like we negotiate any other code change. And of course, when I say schema evolution, I generally mean adding fields, removing fields, changing fields. I could add a field to an enum. I could say, we're going to start tracking social security number. Or we're going to merge first name and last name into name and remove a field, all that kind of thing. Those are all valid kinds of schema evolution. So we've got data into our Kafka cluster through Kafka Connect, and we're able to push data out from Kafka also into other systems. We've got Schema Registry to help us manage schema change. What about actually processing that data? Now, you could do anything in a consumer, right? I can just consume data and do whatever kind of processing I want, but that gets pretty difficult. There's a lot of fairly basic stream processing operations like aggregating over a time window that are actually really thorny to write yourself. Well, ksqlDB is a tool that does that. It is the streaming SQL database for Apache Kafka. So if you look at that query there, that looks a lot like regular SQL. There's a join and looks like I'm filtering on something, and there's a pretty sensible join condition there, but there's a lot going on there. And if you were going to do all that yourself in a consumer, that would not be easy, but it is pretty easy to take in through ksqlDB. With ksqlDB, you could do stream processing without standing up any actual programs of your own. So no matter what language you want to use to write your producers and consumers, you're writing your stream processing in ksql. There's a ksqlDB server or cluster of servers that are adjacent to your Kafka cluster. And you can use the REST API to propose those queries to the server, which then they'll run. They'll run there forever. That's what ksql queries do. They never stop. They're always taking new messages in, doing their processing, and emitting new messages into some result topic. You can do that again through the REST interface. There's a CLI that's pretty handy to use. Confluent Control Center, of course, gives you a really nice ksql interface. You can look at running queries, create new queries, look at the results of a query and kind of scroll through them. Pretty handy web UI there. But that's the basic idea. You get to leverage all the power of the built-in Kafka Streams API without having to write a Java program with Kafka Streams or think about any programming language other than ksql itself. And Kafka Streams, I should dive into that a little bit. Kafka Streams is a part of Apache Kafka. It's a Java API. I might say it's a functional Java API. If I really wanted to be formal, I would say it's a fluent functional Java API for doing stream processing on data in Apache Kafka. So definitely, like I said, a Java API, so you're writing a Java program, but a lot of very complex operations like grouping a stream by a key. There's a lot that goes on when I do that. That's a one-liner. Now, to be able to make that work in a scalable and fault-tolerant way, grouping is stateful. I've introduced this whole state management problem, but this is one method call in Kafka Streams. And if I were just trying to do this in the consumer by making my own hash map and collections inside the hash map, and you can kind of imagine how that might work, that's great. But replicating that state, restoring that state if a node fails, scaling that cluster out and moving one partition to the next consumer in the group, all that kind of stuff, there is a lot of framework I'd have to build to do that. That's all inside Kafka Streams, all in that one method call. The method is, let's say, called group by, and all that stuff just happens. It's really, really cool. Other things like joining a stream, taking a stream that we've built off of a compacted topic and turning that into a table, right? And then joining another stream to that table, looking up from some key field events in this topic that have a corresponding key field in this compacted topic over there. You can kind of get that picture in your head, but that's all a few lines of code in Kafka Streams where it would be not very easy to do that yourself. So all kinds of power there. Integrating with exactly once processing semantics, that's a configuration switch that you set and away you go. As I said, scale, I could take a Kafka Streams application, deploy it to one node, scale it out to 10, all that stuff works. And I don't have to do a lot of work to make it happen. Teams that are building microservices in Java will often find themselves using Kafka Streams. It's a very, very good match. And of course, you can do any kind of general stream processing in Kafka Streams that you'd like as well, if you want to do that instead of use ksqlDB. Kafka Streams has a very important architectural opinion, which is that it's a library. Now, you've already got a Kafka cluster, okay? That's one distributed system. We'd like to kind of keep that contained. You've got your consumer group. It's maybe a little bit of a stretch to think of that as a distributed system, but it kind of is. It's this cluster of nodes that Kafka is helping you manage. You don't want to stand up another cluster to deploy your stream processing application to. You want that application to live with your application code. If you're already being a Java application, maybe it's a microservice implemented in Spring Boot and it's got some RESTful interface and exposing some data model out to the world and doing some kind of processing, and you need to add to that advanced stream processing, well, that's a library. You just want to declare that dependency and code against the library and deploy that stream processing with your application. Now, of course, that stream processing is extra work. So if you had a consumer group of, say, two nodes that got the job done, and now you've added all the stream processing, and maybe you need three, maybe you need four if you're doing something really aggressive with a lot of data, that's fine. You already know how to scale a consumer group. Kafka has a story for that. So this is another way in which Kafka is built out of Kafka. Kafka's stream processing API takes advantage of scale and distribution techniques that are already built in this case, to consumer groups. You could kind of think of these as three things along a continuum. Now, the producer and the consumer, those are like the assembly language of Kafka, right? You can literally do anything in those, but you have to literally do everything. So simple things in the producer and consumer API make all the sense in the world. Complex things, you probably don't want that. You want to move to something a little more opinionated, like Kafka streams. But if you look at the kinds of primitives you get, filter, map, join, aggregate, that's what you want. You want those as one-liners. So you're doing a lot less work subject to the more present opinions of the Kafka Streams API. Likewise, you want to keep going down that continuum. You've got KSQL, where it's much more opinionated. It's a dialect of SQL, and you're going to do things that way, but so much easier. Easier to deploy, easier to think about the programs. The programs themselves tend to be much shorter. You know, I've written a Kafka Streams application and then written the equivalent in KSQL, and it can easily be a factor of 5 or 10 lines shorter, maybe more, depending on how you do your line breaks. But KSQL is much simpler and much more opinionated. So you've got this continuum, and you get to choose where you live along that continuum for doing your stream processing. So with those things, Kafka Connect, Confluent Schema Registry, Confluent KSQL DB, and the Apache Kafka Streams API, you've got a good idea how to integrate Kafka into your environment and do real-time processing on the data that you've got in Kafka.